Today, two direct descendants of former President Thomas Jefferson, one white, one black, both calling for public statues of their great-grandfather to come down. With me now is Lucian Truscott, a sixth-generation descendant of Jefferson, and Shannon LaNier, a ninth-generation descendant of Jefferson and his slave, Sally Hemings. Shannon will be there in just a minute as we can get the connection up. But thank you very much for being here, Lucian. You have a very powerful new piece in the New York Times, and you call for the removal of the Jefferson Memorial in Washington, D.C., something the National Park Service describes as a, quote, shrine to freedom. But here's what you write, quote, "The memorial is a shrine to a man who during his lifetime owned more than 600 slaves and had at least six children with one of them. It's a shrine to a man who famously wrote that all men are created equal and yet never did much to make those words come true." And you make the case that Monticello, right, his estate, is a better representation of his life and an almost perfect memorial. Explain why.
It puts Jefferson in context. If you visit Monticello now, you'll take a tour and learn about slave life, as much about slave life at Monticello as you do about Jefferson himself.
Yeah.
On any given day there at Monticello, when he moved there after leaving the presidency, there were about 125 slaves and one white guy, him. And sometimes his daughter, you know, his grandson would visit and so forth. But generally, it was Thomas Jefferson and his slaves. Now you get that history. They've uncovered Sally Hemings's a bedroom, which is a cave-like structure under one of the wings of Monticello. My brother and I used to play in that room when we were boys. And they put it on display and as part of the history of Monticello. This is where Sally Hemings lived. This is where the woman who had six of Jefferson's children lived. And you can take tours that that just explore slave life. So I think that it gives a picture of Jefferson in full, with his flaws and his greatness intact.
Your argument is that the Jefferson Memorial should come down because it doesn't do that. Let me bring in Shannon LaNier to this conversation as well. Shannon, really, really good to have you. And for anyone who hasn't seen this video, I want them to just look at this as we discuss as well. You've got it on your Instagram, but it's you dressed just like your great, great, great grandfather, the third president of the United States. And you say, look, quote, "He owned people, and now I'm here because of it. My ancestor had his dreams, and now it's all up to us living in America today to make sure that no one is excluded from the promise of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." What does the Jefferson Memorial represent to you, as you argue for it to come down?
Well, I think a lot of these public statues were put in place for the wrong reasons and to glorify people who were flawed. I think we have to start looking at these people as human beings, not gods, not idols to be looked upon. And then we need to have representation of freedom, which, you know, they said the Jefferson Memorial is supposed to represent that, but yet he didn't do anything to help create a free and equal society for people. So if they are going to keep the Jefferson Memorial, I think that they have to do what Lucian is saying that they're doing with Monticello, show the complete and entire story of who this man was, that yes, people have been giving him a pass for years because he helped found this country, but he also helped do it on the backs of slaves, whether that was their blood, sweat, and tears that they had to put in to do it.
You are a descendant of, you know, he had a number of children from relationships with slaves. You are a descendant of his slave, Sally Hemings. Talk about who you think should go, because it's fascinating, in the place of the Jefferson Memorial, that it should be one of the founding mothers.
Yeah, you know, there are so many people that represent freedom more than Jefferson's actually stood for. He said one thing, but he didn't practice that thing. So you could look at Harriet Tubman. You could look at Sally Hemings. You could look at many of the people that fought for the equal rights and freedom of people to be able to be free in this country and really stood for what it stands for. Or maybe you include all of them and make it just an entire shrine to all these people. But I mean, the point is people are going to find flaws with people. People are flawed people, and we have to look at those people in their entirety. And that's what history is about. We're not erasing history. We're teaching the full story of what history is and what these people did to and for our country.
Lucian, you think Harriet Tubman?
Yes, that's what I suggested in the Times. Harriet Tubman, I call one of the founding mothers. of this country. I think we've paid enough attention to the founding fathers over the years, and it's time to celebrate some of the women that helped found this country. And I describe Harriet Tubman as helping to found the America that came along after slavery. She fought to free slaves before the Civil War. She fought during the Civil War on the side of the Union as a spy and a scout, and then she fought for the rights of freed slaves after the Civil War. So I think it's time to honor her or someone like her in the place of Thomas Jefferson. You know, you go to visit Washington, D.C., you see Jefferson everywhere. There's Jefferson Hotel, Jefferson Street, Jefferson Monument, all over the place. We've had enough of this.
Okay.
And why not the symbol of freedom and equality? Maybe it's not a person. Maybe it's a symbol of unity, which this country is desperately needing right now, unity.
To both of you, I'd like you to address the argument being made by the president. And to you first, Shannon. I mean, he calls people who want to remove these statues. He says they are angry mobs and people who want to end America. You heard him say such a few days ago, right, at Mount Rushmore. What do you say?
And I don't agree with that at all. We're trying to equal the playing field, to try to provide some context to the content that's out there. We can't just put up these statues and expect people to praise them, not knowing their history, not knowing all the bad that they've done. Yes, they've done great things, but they also have a tarnished history and a tarnished past, and we need to recognize all that they've done. And if these statues are demoralizing people, putting people down, then we should remove them so people can feel comfortable in the tax-paying environments that they're living in, not hail them in public squares where they're looked down upon and trying to put people in their place just by being there, which was some of their original intent for these statues.
Lucian, let me end on this and ask you something. My hometown of Minneapolis, Minnesota, the county there, Hennepin County, Minnesota, just a few days ago, was, of course, it's where George Floyd was murdered, has declared racism a public health crisis. I wonder if you think that is something that we should see across the country in many municipalities, and if that would help move this conversation and action forward.
I think it would. I think it's obvious what a health crisis racism is. We've just seen the figures, I think, today or yesterday, for how much African Americans and Latinos and other minorities are affected by the COVID virus. It's right there in front of us what a threat racism is to this country. What we need in this country is a reckoning. We need to confront the racist past of the country. We need to confront slavery in a way we've never done before. And I think that bringing down some of these statues like Thomas Jefferson is part of the way to do it. And I don't know how you could describe me and my cousin Shannon as a mob unless you think two people are a mob.
Yeah.
We're anything but angry.
We have to leave it there. You've both written such important things. And I know you two have been friends now, not only relatives, but friends for the last 20 plus years. It's a real pleasure to have both of you on, Shannon LaNier and Lucian Truscott. Thank you both so much.